It is just a diagnosis of exclusion. When you can't find a diagnosis for a particular pathology in the larynx that you see, is it the surgeon's or ENT surgeon's graveyard? So let us see whether it is a myth or a reality. Let me share the screen. I hope the voice is audible.
Yes, ma'am. You can go ahead.
Okay, laryngopharyngeal reflux, a myth or reality. So this is where I work, the Sion Hospital, which is called as LTN, LTMGH Medical College, where it is currently dealing with all the cases of COVID patients. And this is where HN Reliance Hospital, where I work as a voice surgeon. So LPR, that is laryngopharyngeal reflux, is accused of being a causative factor for various laryngeal pathologies, may it be nodule or carcinoma or Reinke's edema, name it, and LPR is accused to be as a causative factor. So is it really so? And what is LPR? How do you diagnose LPR? How do you grade it? Is it the same as GERD? What are its symptoms? Let us find out. So basically, GER, that is gastroesophageal reflux, is the backflow of the stomach contents into the esophagus. Our esophagus can bear up to multiple episodes of these refluxes, and around 50 episodes per day are considered within normal range. GERD refers to the GER, that is the gastroesophageal reflux, which is an excess, and that causes tissue damage and or clinical symptoms. Now, what is LPR? LPR is the backflow of the stomach contents into the laryngopharynx. So this LPRD, that is a laryngopharyngeal reflux disease, refers to the symptoms, signs, and the tissue abnormalities of the pharynx, larynx, and other associated respiratory organs, which result from the damage caused by the reflux of the gastric contents into the upper aerodigestive tract. So this term was proposed by Kaufman in 1996. What is the prevalence? It's supposedly the underlying etiology in almost 40 to 60% of the patients with voice disorders. 10% of patients presenting to EAD have laryngopharyngeal reflux. And 50% of all cases of voice or swallowing disorders exhibit some form of laryngopharyngeal reflux symptoms. Now, there are certain confounding facts. What are they? GERD, that is the gastroesophageal reflux, is a prevalent disorder, but only a small proportion of these patients have supraesophageal problems. Although patients of LPR have abnormal esophageal acid exposure, but very few, almost 50% only, have esophageal symptoms, that is esophagitis. And response to agents that inhibit the gastric acid secretions has not been as clear as response to the esophageal signs and symptoms of the reflux disease. So there are certain confounding factors, that is mainly all patients of LPR don't have GERD, that is the esophagitis or GERD symptoms. All cases of GERD do not have LPR. And the response to decreasing the gastric acid secretions is controversial or not 100% effective. So what are the clinical manifestations of laryngopharyngeal reflux? Now, there's a whole list of symptoms and conditions which you can see. It can cause dysphonia, vocal fatigue, voice breaks, chronic throat clearing. So you can name a condition and it's there in the list. So what you see is reflux laryngitis, some amount of idiopathic stenosis is known to be caused by reflux, carcinoma of the larynx, contact ulcers or granulomas, paroxysmal laryngeal spasms, paroxysmal vocal cord movement, globus pharynges, and sometimes vocal nodules also are caused by the reflux symptoms. What is the pathology? I mean, how do these various things can be caused by just laryngopharyngeal reflux? How are the symptoms of the reflux related to what is happening? So basically, the pathophysiology is multifactorial. It can be because of the direct injury of the acid onto the larynx or because of a secondary mechanism. The association of LPR and GERD is yet to be established. It's only because of the proximity of these structures we can assume that there can be a causal association between the acid reflux and the LPR. So direct injury is by the direct acid pepsin injury to the larynx causes laryngeal inflammation, or reflux causes damage to the cilia within the pharynx and the larynx, which causes mucosal stasis, which causes the symptoms of throat clearing and cough, which in turn can give rise to laryngeal inflammation or irritation. So this is a secondary sort of an action of the reflux causing damage to the cilia, throat clearing, and that in turn leading to laryngeal inflammation. Or it can be an indirect way in the way that acid in the distal esophagus causes stimulation of the vagal mediator reflexes, which causes chronic throat clearing and coughing, bronchoconstrictions, which may lead to the mucosal lesions that you see within the larynx and the pharynx. What is the role of pepsin in all this? Pepsin is known to be a main mucosal irritant in the laryngopharyngeal reflux. So apart from the acid, pepsin also has a very important role to play in causative factors for the LPR syndrome. It digests the proteins and impairs the functions of the upper respiratory tract cells by affecting the carbonic anhydrase. We'll come to this later. There's certain enzymatic reactions that it causes. It initiates the inflammatory changes within the larynx, nasopharynx, and the nasal cavity. And it can stay in an active form even when the pH is 7. Even when the pH is not acidic in the pharynx and the larynx, it can still stay active for more than 24 hours. So, is there any role of Helicobacter? Yes, there has been a correlation between the signs of laryngitis and the grades of esophagitis and H. pylori colonization in the stomach. Many patients complain of globus pharynges. It is some foreign body sensation kind of symptom in the throat. So, these symptoms are because of the inflammation and swelling of the laryngopharyngeal structures. The foreign body sensation also can be because of the esophagitis in the absence of the direct LPR, and also because of the hypotonicity of the upper esophageal sphincter. Now, how is CA larynx? How can LPR be a causative factor for CA larynx? Is there any specific carcinogenic substance within the reflux? No, it is known to be multifactorial. Cause, that is the mucosal injury, which is caused by smoking, tobacco, alcohol, plus the reflux, which can cause the penetration or reactivation of the papilloma virus, leading to carcinoma of the larynx. How is stenosis leading to how is stenosis caused by LPR? It's not really confirmed, but it is said that LPR or GER is an important etiologic factor in case of idiopathic stenosis. And if you're going to operate a patient for stenosis, treatment of GER, gastroesophageal reflux disease, is mandatory before you take up the patient for such a surgery. What are the reflux, anti-reflux barriers? So one is the upper esophageal sphincter. Second is the esophageal motor function with acid clearance, that is the movement of the esophagus. the esophageal mucosal resistance to the acid and the lower esophageal sphincter. What can affect these barriers? So if the lower esophageal sphincter has a decreased relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter, which may be because of hiatus hernia, various kinds of foods, tobacco, alcohol, certain drugs, and GERD itself can cause lowering of the lower esophageal sphincter pressure, or abnormal esophageal motility in case of, if there is decreased motility and decreased clearance of the acid in case of neuromuscular diseases, alcohol, GERD, or in case of laryngectomy, or abnormal mucosal resistance because of now the saliva, when the saliva that we swallow is known to neutralize the acid within the esophagus. So xerostomia, again alcohol, smoking, tobacco, and certain drugs decrease this mucosal resistance. Other factors which can cause a problem in the barriers is a delayed gastric emptying time or an increased abdominal pressure. And obviously increase in the gastric secretion that can be caused by stress, tobacco, alcohol, drugs, and diet. Now, why you would say if the patient has laryngopharyngeal reflux disease, he certainly should be having gastroesophageal reflux disease also. But why is it not that all cases of LPRD do not have GERD as well? How is the esophagus resistant to the acid but the larynx is not? So there is active bicarbonate within the esophagus, which is pumped into the extracellular space of the esophagus, which neutralizes the acid, which is not present in the larynx. And there is an increased susceptibility to the LPRD in some patient population. Now, why is that so? Let's see. Carbonic anhydrase converts the carbon dioxide to bicarbonate by hydration. Now, this bicarbonate neutralizes the acid in the reflux. Carbonic anhydrase is normally present in the normal larynx. If this is absent, then patients develop laryngopharyngeal reflux symptoms. This is known to be absent in 64% of the patients. So when they did a biopsy of the specimens of the laryngeal mucosa, they found this carbonic anhydrase absent in 64% of the biopsy patients. So this carbonic anhydrase plays an important role in the in neutralizing the acid in the reflux. What is the difference between GERD, that is a gastroesophageal reflux disease, and LPRD? So GERD is the backflow of the gastric contents into the esophagus, whereas LPRD is the backflow of the gastric contents into the larynx and the hypopharynx. GERD patient is known to have prolonged esophageal clearance or esophageal dysmotility syndrome, whereas LPRD, evidence of any prolonged esophageal clearance or esophageal dysmotility. There is significant esophagitis and heartburn in GERD, whereas there are no signs of esophagitis in LPRD. In GERD, the esophagus can tolerate more than 45 reflux episodes per day. Symptoms develop when there are more than 45 reflux episodes per day in GERD. Wherein laryngopharyngeal reflux, even one or two episodes of reflux into the larynx per week is enough to cause laryngopharyngeal reflux disease, that is the pathology within the larynx. So even one or two reflux episodes into the larynx per week can cause LPRD. So this is again, these are the symptoms. GERD patient will present with heartburn, regurgitation, and dyspepsia. Whereas in LPRD, patient has hoarseness, globus pharyngeus, that is a foreign body sensation, dysphagia, cough, chronic throat clearing, and sore throat. Just a request that if the participants can close off their video, because then the streaming will be much easier with the videos in the off mode.
Yeah, I've turned off all the videos, ma'am. You can proceed.
Yeah. So when will you suspect laryngopharyngeal reflux? If there is a lack of an etiology for some chronic laryngeal symptoms and findings, recurrent and persistent nature of these disorders, and empirically, if you treat a patient with certain findings, if you find benefit with that treatment. But is there any specific way to diagnose LPRD rather than just by a method of exclusion? So let us see. There are certain specific symptoms which are named, which are categorized into reflux symptom index. We'll come to that, individual symptoms. And there are certain specific laryngeal signs which can be termed as reflux finding score. So what is reflux symptom index? Now, this is a self-administered 9-item scoring system where the patient analyzes his symptoms and notes down and grades those symptoms. Now, what are these symptoms? This is a chart where you ask the patient that within the last month, how did the following problems affect you? So if the patient has hoarseness or problem with the voice, then it is graded as 0, which is no problem at all, and 5 is severe problem. So from 0 to 5, the patient grades the symptom of hoarseness, clearing of throat, excess throat mucus, difficulty in swallowing food, liquids or pills, coughing after eating or lying down, breathing difficulties or choking episodes, especially in the night, troublesome or annoying cough, sensation of something sticking in the throat, there is a global sensation, indigestion or acid coming up. Okay, so the scoring is obtained, and if the score is more than 13, it is strongly suggestive of LPR. This is called as a reflux symptom index. So if RSI is more than 13, then it is strongly suggestive of laryngopharyngeal reflux. Now these, this RSI and the reflux finding score, these have been validated. They have conducted trials of patients with these symptoms. Then all the tests, that is the pH manometry, esophagoscopy and everything, and they have validated these scores with the other invasive investigations. So these scores are, so even if the patient is not subjected to invasive investigations, if you have these scores, these are strong, and if these scores are positive, they are strongly suggestive of laryngopharyngeal reflux. So what is reflux finding score? Now, reflux finding score is something which you see on laryngoscopy, either with a flexible or a rigid laryngoscope. Now, this is a normal larynx, what a normal larynx would look like. But what do you find in a larynx which has laryngopharyngeal reflux? So what is reflux finding score? So now there are certain 8 findings that you need to see in the larynx. So first is a pseudosulcus vocalis. We'll come to that. So it is graded from 1 to 4. That is 0 is when there is no pseudosulcus seen, and 2 when it is present. Ventricular obliteration, that is when the false vocal cords are hypertrophied, the ventricle is not seen well or it's obliterated. So the score is 0 when there is no obliteration, 2 is when there is partial obliteration, and 4 when there is complete obliteration. Erythema or hyperemia, that is the laryngeal erythema or hyperemia, 0 when it is none. If it is 2 when only the arytenoids are congested, and if there is diffuse erythema, then it is grade 4. vocal fold edema, again, it is graded from 0 to 4, and so are the other findings. Now, let us see what are the other findings. That is the diffuse laryngeal edema, posterior commissure hypertrophy, granuloma, and thick endolaryngeal mucus. So, if the RFS, that is the reflux finding score, is more than 7, then there is 95% probability of the patient having laryngopharyngeal reflux. Maximum score can be 26. So, what is pseudosulcus vocalis? I suppose everyone would have are aware of the term sulcus vocalis. So, now sulcus vocalis is when there is a longitudinal depression or a groove running all along the vocal cord, but that is restricted to the membranous vocal cord. That is, the sulcus will not extend beyond the membranous vocal cord, that it will not go into the cartilaginous part of the glottis. Now, if you can see this, that you can see a groove which is running all across the vocal cord, but it is also running posteriorly beyond the membranous vocal fold. So that is not a true sulcus, but it's an apparent sulcus developed because of the subglottic edema, which looks like a sulcus. So the subglottic edema, when the patient has that, it extends from the anterior commissure to the posterior larynx. So this is termed as sulcus vocalis, pseudosulcus vocalis. If it is present, it is graded at two points, and if it is absent, is 0 points. The next finding is ventricular obliteration. Now, this is a normal ventricle. Okay, you can see the ventricle here. That is, ventricle is a space, lateral extension of between the of space between the false cord and the true vocal cords. This was a case of laryngopharyngeal reflux. If you can see, there is obliteration of the ventricle because this hypertrophy of the false vocal cords as well as the true cords, which causes the obliteration of the ventricle. So swelling of the true cords as well as false cord obliterates the space, and this finding is seen in 80% of the patients of cases of LPR, and this finding is completely reversed on successful anti-reflux treatment. So in 0 is none, partial 2 is partial, and if it is complete obliteration, it's graded as 4. Laryngeal erythema, if there is only restricted to the arytenoids, is graded as 4. It's given as 2 points, and diffuse laryngeal erythema is given 4 points. Vocal cord edema. Now, so if there is a mild edema, is graded as 1 point if only slight swelling is present. But if there is a polypoid degeneration of the both the vocal folds, then it is given 4 points. As you can see, this is diffuse Renke's edema of the both vocal cords, which is seen in this case. The fifth point is posterior laryngitis, that is a post hypertrophy of the posterior commissure. Now, it is graded as grade 1 if there is just a mustache-like appearance. Grade 2 if there is a straight line running across the back of the larynx. Grade 3 if you see a bulge of the posterior commissure into the larynx, into the airway. And grade 4 if it is causing significant portion obstruction or obliteration of the airway. It's termed as grade 4. And this finding is present in 85% of the cases of LPR. The posterior granuloma present in the posterior larynx, presence is given 2 points. And if its absence is 0 points. Now, and the other point is the thick endolaryngeal mucus. That thick viscid secretions is presence or absence is graded as 0 or 2 points. Now, this patient had many of the findings of the reflux find FRFS, that what you can see, there is ventricular obliteration, you can see vocal fold edema, you can see laryngeal erythema, you can see posterior commissure hypertrophy, also you can see sulcus vocalis, the pseudosulcus vocalis. So there are multiple, and there is a very slight vocal cord granuloma which is seen on the right vocal fold. So few patients can have most of the symptoms of RFS. So the maximum score is 26, and a score of 7 or more is considered diagnostic of LPR. But there may be some subjective variations depending upon the otolaryngologist. So the criticism of RFS is that it can vary to between various otolaryngologists because it's a subjective finding. But one should be aware that LPR should not be overdiagnosed or misdiagnosed. Now, if you find certain unilateral findings in a larynx, then you should suspect that it is not LPR. Now, in this patient, you could see unilateral vocal fold edema, congestion. There is a granuloma posteriorly. There is also some amount of posterior commissure hypertrophy. There is ventricular obliteration also. But this is a unusual finding in LPR. You never have unilateral finding. So we took this patient for examination and his anesthesia, took a biopsy of this mucosa of the left vocal fold, and to our surprise, we found that it was tuberculosis of the larynx, and which reversed completely with anti-Cox treatment. So be wary of misdiagnosing laryngopharyngeal disease or overdiagnosing laryngopharyngeal disease. You should not miss a carcinoma, or you should not overdiagnose it or misdiagnose it. So when we had done a study of our patients, and we found that pachydermia, that is the posterior commissure hypertrophy, to be the maximum finding in most of the patients, of more than 90% of the patients of the LPR, we found this finding. The next finding that we found was vocal fold edema. I think this was the study which we had done of 100 cases, 127 cases we found LPR, 127 cases of hoarseness. We found laryngopharyngeal reflux disease in 31 of these patients, based on the RFS and RSI scores. We also correlated the RSI and the RFS scores in that when the RSI score was more than 13, the RFS also was seen to be more than 7 in majority of the patients. In cases where the RSI was less than 13, that the reflux symptom index was less than 13, then RFS, that is the finding score, was also lesser in these patients. So what are there any other tests for diagnosis of LPR? Now, earlier when these RFS, that is the finding score, and RSI, that is the reflux symptom index, were not validated to diagnose LPR, there were other tests. So those are 24-hour pH monitoring. This is the gold standard for diagnosing GERD, that is the gastroesophageal reflux. Now, it's an invasive test. It's a costly. It's also costly, and it's cumbersome to the patient because you have to insert probes into the pharynx and the esophagus and evaluate the laryngeal acid reflux events that are occurring. They have found that it has lower sensitivity in patients with negative digest endoscopic findings. Other tests are impedance monitoring, but also the non-acid reflux events which are occurring in the pharynx and the esophagus. A simpler test would be to detect pepsin in the saliva. It has a very good sensitivity and specificity also. And it is non-invasive. It is very rapid test, and it is not at all cumbersome to the patient. So it can detect pepsin within the spit, that is the saliva of the patient. And the other test to diagnose esophagitis or any gastroesophageal reflux disease along with LPR, you need to do a transnasal esophagoscopy. Or empirical trial of PPI therapy is also known to be a diagnostic test for LPR. So what is the management of laryngopharyngeal reflux? The mainstay of treatment is lifestyle modification. Smoking, alcohol, increased intake of tea or coffee, intake of spicy, oily, and sour foods has to be avoided. Reduce the intake of citrus juices and fizzy drinks or cola drinks. There has to be an appropriate spacing between the meals. Avoid eating within 3 hours of bedtime, rather not bedtime or lying down. A patient has to avoid lying down immediately after meals. Reduce weight if the patient is obese, because as you saw that one of the causes for breaking of the barriers of the ear reflux is the increase in the intra-abdominal pressure. Also, the BMR and BMI has to be monitored. So, low-fat diet, avoid certain medicines such as calcium channel blockers, theophylline, anticholinergic drugs. These cause decrease in the capacity of the lower esophageal sphincter. Medical line of management is the mainstay is PPI. What these do, they reduce the gastric acid production by blocking the gastric proton pump. And the medicines are typically omeprazole, lansoprazole, and rabeprazole. I prefer omeprazole in the dose of twice a day, 20 milligram twice a day, because it gives an even spacing of the medicine over 24 hours. It is known to be sponge disease. Antacids, they give symptomatic relief against the acid component of the gastric refluxid. And the H2 receptor agonist, they combat the histamine-regulated nocturnal acid breakthrough or release of acid. So the medicines are ranitidine, cimetidine, and famotidine. Studies have found that it gives 50% clinical response in 50% of the patients. And once you stop this, there is again recurrence of symptoms. So PPIs are the mainstay of medical treatment. A response rate is more than 70%. That is, in more than 70% patients, you can get a response. PPI therapy is superior to placebo. So it's not just a placebo effect. So commonly what is used is omeprazole, 20 milligram dose twice a day. Now there are certain side effects if you give PPIs indiscriminately for very long periods. Common side effects which are seen are headache, diarrhea, or upset stomach. You have to use it with caution in patients with hepatic impairment. And also patients with chronic kidney diseases, there's risk of magnesia as well. And it's known to cause, there are certain increased risk factors for bone fractures. What are the other medicines? So the other medicines are alginates, which are very effective. So what they do is they form a sort of a layer on top of your gastric contents. They coat the gastric contents and act as a barrier to keep the stomach content from coming up. So this is very effective and in preventing the reflux, and it has to be given immediately after meals. It removes 90% of the pepsin and the bile in the first reflux episode. which is also called as a sieving pepsin. What can be the algorithm for treatment? So when you initially assess a patient with LPR and you score the patient on the basis of reflux symptom and the reflux finding score, if the reflux finding score is more than 7 and if the reflux symptom index is more than 13, then you give an empirical trial of a PPI and advise the patient lifestyle modifications, as I mentioned earlier. After 2-month follow-up with regular assessment of the patient's findings on larynx, if the symptoms resolve, then you titrate the therapy and you can give it over a period of 2 months and then stop the medications. If the symptoms have improved significantly, you still continue the PPI, follow up the patient, and once the symptoms have resolved, you resolve completely, you stop the therapy. If the symptoms remain unchanged, then patient has to be assessed further in terms of referral to a gastroenterologist for esophagoscopy, for manometry and pH monitoring. So this is a laryngoscopic finding of a patient who was diagnosed to have laryngopharyngeal disease. This is pre-treatment. So you can see that patient has posterior commissure hypertrophy, patient has ventricular obliteration, has pseudosulcus vocalis, vocal fold edema. So these are the findings before therapy. 1 month after therapy, all the findings except posterior commissure hypertrophy, all the findings are seen to be reversed. One of our papers on LPR, we have found that all the symptoms, all the findings reverse except the posterior commissure hypertrophy. So this findings still stays, the hypertrophy still stays in spite of the resolution of the symptoms of LPR. Surgery is really not done or very rarely done. It's when if the patient has hiatus hernia and there's no response to therapy, then a fundoplication is advised. To summarize, clinical diagnosis of LPR is challenging. Look for subtle signs, which I mentioned as in reflux finding score. Do not overdiagnose. If there is no improvement, look for other causes of the laryngeal findings that you're seeing. Management includes not only drug therapy, but lifestyle modifications, which the patient has to continue despite after stopping the drug therapy. Aggressive acid suppression with PPIs twice a day for at least 2 months is warranted for treatment of laryngopharyngeal disease. And it has to be a multidisciplinary approach with the gastroenterologist, with your physician, to rule out other causes of chronic cough. So to conclude also our initial query, so LPR is not a myth, but a reality. So thank you, and let's hope that we have a tranquil and a healthier world post-corona, and very soon we should be hopeful to see a good, healthy new world. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for an excellent presentation. We have some queries, ma'am, on the chat box. I'll read out one by one.
Yes.
So Dr. Omkar Vedak was asking, how do you approach a patient with a foreign body sensation in the throat?
Okay. When the patient complains of foreign body sensation, one thing mandatory is you have to examine the larynx. Indiscriminate prescription of antacids and PPIs have to be avoided. you have to examine the larynx, look for any signs of laryngopharyngeal reflux, symptoms of reflux within the larynx. And if the patient complains of dysphagia along with foreign body sensation, that is, there is complaint of blocking sensation or difficulty in swallowing, then you have to investigate the patient further with barium swallow or barium esophagogram and esophagoscopy.
Treatment-wise, is there any difference between GERD and LPRD?
In LPR, the treatment with to resolve the pepsin reflux is very important. So along with the PPIs, you give alginates, which are very good neutralizers for the pepsin, which is present within the reflux, within the larynx. And it is also essential that you monitor the progress or improvement of the LPR by doing regular scopies.
Ma'am, Dr. Priya was asking, what is the relation between GERD with allergic rhinitis? And do the symptoms worsen if we give additional treatment?
Symptoms of allergic rhinitis worsen or
it was not clear whether she was referring to allergic rhinitis or GERD. Maybe she can clarify again. Ma'am, what are the additional diagnostic tests for LPR in major laboratories?
Yeah, so the pepsin, the salivary pepsin is not very important, but it is a very simple test. But although it is not very rampantly in our country, but it's a very simple test and very sensitive, as well as it has a good specificity also. The other invasive tests which are done by the gastroenterologist are the pH monitoring, where you insert probes, pH monitoring probes, and also the esophageal manometry and the transnasal esophagoscopy. These are done when you have given a trial of LPR treatment, but your laryngeal symptoms are not resolving, or if the patient does have esophagitis or symptoms related to GERD also, then you straight away do these investigations or get those investigations done by the gastroenterologist.
What is the role of mucolytics like N-acetylcysteine?
Mucolytics generally don't play a very major role, but if you feel that there is very viscid secretion within the larynx, then they can be given.
Dr. Amar,
basically, your findings will dictate as to what medicine you want to use.
Dr. Amrapali Power was asking, why do you not combine omeprazole with prokinetics like domperidone?
Yes, it can be combined. There was a study saying that there have been very varied reports regarding that. It does help to decrease, prokinetics do help, but there have been studies that it has found to be of no use. But there is no harm in giving that. So many laryngologists do combine omeprazole with prokinetics. There is no harm.
Dr. Kannan was asking, can you elaborate on lifestyle modifications?
Yeah. So one thing which I missed is that I always tell the patients to have adequate quantity of water, because that also is an additional factor that it dries up the laryngeal mucosa, and subsequently patient has this constant clearing of the throat, okay, because of that. Second thing is weight reduction is very important to decrease the symptoms of LPR, because GERD also, basically the esophagitis and the reflux plays a very important role in the symptoms of LPR. I mean, you have to decrease the reflux, gastroesophageal reflux also, not just LPR. So you have to give lifestyle modification is to do proper exercise, reduce weight, eat proper diet, that is decrease the oily and the spicy food as well as the sour food. Do not patient has to be has to avoid fizzy drinks, that is one carbonated drinks, that is the cola or you know some, the cold drinks that you get. Also the tea coffee intake has to decrease, that because that increases the acidity. Patient is advised not to lie down immediately after meals. So there has to be a gap of at and lying down. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Sorry, was there some connection problem?
Dr. Munka, sir, please go ahead.
Good evening. Yes. It was an excellent presentation. Certain points I would like to ask your opinion since yes. you are working on that. You have done excellent endoscopies. One thing, essentially the approach to both the conditions, GERD and LPR, are the same yes. treatment-wise. Mm. So that what we say to the patient is it's a lifestyle disease, you have to modify. That is my opinion. Please, if you don't agree, you clarify. Yes. Must ask for a GI endoscopy, but many a times a person whosoever comes to ENT guys already have symptoms for a couple of weeks. And on GI endo, upper GI endoscopy, my gastroenterology friend says there is a small growth in the esophagus. Mm. I get it followed up by a barium solo analysis and sometimes motility disorders are there. So sisapride now it is not available. Mosopride, mosapride, they also help as an adjuvant. Since you know the ulcer treatment has got so many drugs. Now the newer drugs like isoprazole and a lot of, you know, omeprazole,
yes.
pentaprazole, rabeprazole, they are all there. Probably that differs from patient to each other. Omeprazole, yes, I agree. In my practice also, that is the maximum used. But I will always like to insist to get an upper GI endoscopy if it is not responding within 2 to 3 weeks. Because in my experience, I have come across many a cases having a small growth, then you have to cut a very sorry figure. So what is your opinion, ma'am?
Yeah. So what I have my personal experience as well as when I have gone through various papers, the algorithm which is followed is this, that if the patient does not have symptoms of gastritis or esophagitis and has symptoms of LPR, then a treatment with PPI is initiated first. Within 4 weeks, if you're seeing improvement within the first 4 weeks of treatment, as you said, you continue with the treatment. Okay, if you see the improvement. But of course, if you're not seeing any improvement, then you have to take a gastroenterologist's opinion. But if you're seeing improvement, this treatment continues for a period of 2 months. Yeah.
Usually they already had some of the PPIs, they come to you. So that is to be taken into consideration.
Just let me complete. So when we have found that the treatment has to be continued for at least 2 months, but to achieve better results, we have seen that the treatment should continue for a further period of total 6 months. Because the response to the treatment takes some time. It doesn't, you don't see the response immediately. The initial response you start seeing at 4 weeks, but the good response is seen only after initiation of treatment for more than 2 months. So there is a certain mentality that once you start seeing improvement, you stop the medicines. So that is not, that should not be the case. You have to instruct the patients that the medication has to continue for a further period, for a long period of time.
Good answer. I think, but it is always, I will like to suggest to all that we must rule out a upper GI endoscopy should be done, because 2 months if you wait and then if something comes positive, it's very difficult to explain.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's what I said. If you don't see any improvement within the first 3 to 4 weeks of your treatment,
exactly.
Further investigation of the patient by a gastroenterologist is a must. The LPR should not be overdiagnosed.
Because those are the guys who...
Yes.
And those are the guys who will criticize you most that you didn't send the patient on time. What about your experience with H. pylori kit? Are they still using? Because I find even the gastroenterologists are not using very often as they used to use.
At least the gastroenterologists, yes, they do.
Now they are using less and less. I don't know why.
That's what I mean. There have been multiple studies, and there has been a connection of H. pylori. There are certain studies which say that there is no connection. So certain gastroenterologists do believe in one. So there are different schools of thought. So that I totally depend upon the gastroenterologist to decide what they want to do about the H. pylori.
No, I asked Dr. Naga Reddy. Nageswar Reddy is a famous gastroenterologist of the country. He said, well, there is no harm. If the patient is not responding with lifestyle and PPI, you can give a course for, depending on, 6 weeks is ideal. But if you feel, you can give it. So that was not very emphatic. So I wanted to have your opinion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Ma'am, one common question which was being asked was, what is an average duration do you give the treatment for PPI?
Yeah. So the minimum period for which I give is 2 months minimum. And if patient has improvement, then further treatment, if a patient has improvement to sustain the effects of the PPIs, I continue the treatment for 6 months. Because we have seen that when you give continue the treatment, if there are little symptoms still there, it's better to continue the treatment. But if, as I again reiterate, that LPR is not to be overdiagnosed, or you should not keep it as a diagnosis of exclusion. So if you don't see the improvement in 1 month, then you look for other causes of the laryngeal findings that you're seeing.
Dr. Abhishek Gupta was asking, he's having two questions. What is the role of ranitidine in view of ongoing controversy? And what is the role of anti-allergic medication?
Ranitidine, I don't use much actually, so I really cannot comment on that. Role of anti-allergic is, sometimes when a patient comes with foreign body sensation or throat clearing, and you don't know whether the cause is laryngopharyngeal reflux or you don't know whether it's the allergy that is causing this. So many a times I do give treatment, and if you don't see classic findings of LPR, nor is any reflux symptom index is not suggestive, then I do give anti-allergic treatment alongside the treatment for LPR.
Actually, there was some confusion regarding Dr. Amrapali Pawar's question. Actually, his question was, are the diagnostic tests readily done in all major laboratories?
You mean the pepsin test?
Yes.
Yeah, so there very few laboratories have that. It is not yet very common test, but it is going to come up in a big way, because it's a very simple test and it's absolutely non-invasive and is very sensitive. So in maybe smaller metropolitan cities, it may not be available.
One more question was, what is the role of steam inhalation and decongestants in LPR?
No.
And what is the role of steroids in LPR?
No role of steroids.
So then how to approach a patient?
Unless a patient has spasm of the cords or some severe subglottic edema due to the reflux and has spasm, laryngospasms due to the subglottic edema. Other than that, I don't see any role.
How do you approach a patient with low hemoglobin and throat pain?
If it's throat pain or dysphagia, I mean, the antennae should come up with if the patient has anemia and some throat problem, you should rule out any the upper esophageal issues. So any scopy, apart from correcting the anemia, you should advise the esophagoscopy for the patient to rule out any upper esophageal stenosis or problem.
Does post-nasal drip due to allergic rhinitis cause LPR?
Whether the egg has come first or the chicken has come first, it's something like that. It's post-nasal drip is known to be due to LPR. But LPR, the post-nasal drip will not cause LPR.
Ma'am, Dr. Tohir was asking, what is the relationship between GERD and hypertrophy of posterior part of inferior nasal turbinates?
I've never come across this, but yeah, I mean, a causative fact, because the reflux can cause this, because certain nasal symptoms, sinusitis, CSOM, all are known to be caused by reflux.
What is the role of enzymes like trypsin, chymotrypsin in LPR?
I have not given unless the patient has laryngeal edema. So if the patient has laryngeal edema, then I do give trypsin, chymotrypsin or salicylpeptidase to decrease the laryngeal edema and erythema.
Dr. Abhijit was asking, is endoscopy required in the first visit?
Absolutely, yes.
Ma'am, and what about this PPIs in pregnant women? Are they safe?
Ranitidine, yes, it is safe. I mean, only PPIs. But I always, whenever there is a pregnant female, I always take a gynecology opinion before prescribing any medication.
If we give PPIs for long term, is there any risk of malignancy?
No, it is not known to cause malignancy, but there are certain, osteoporosis or bone fracture, kidney problems and hepatic problems associated with PPIs long term.
Dr. Alok Mondal was asking, what is your experience with baclofen?
No, I have not used that.
Can LPR cause neck pain or spasms?
Yes, cervical dysphagia is known to be a known symptom. Neck pain, the back pain, you mean, muscle? No, I have not come across any patient with that.
Dr. Satish.
Back pain, yes. If esophageal spasm can give rise to interscapular pain.
Dr. Satyanarayana was asking, do PPIs cause polyposis of GI or renal impairment?
Sorry, can I come again?
I'll actually unmute him. I didn't understand. I think he has left the
okay.
So one question, repeated question is, if patients have both LPR and allergic rhinitis, how do you treat?
You treat both.
So I think we have come to the end of the chat box. any participants, they can unmute themselves and ask questions directly if you have any issues. And how do you taper PPI? Is it essential?
If the patient tape, it's not really essential to taper as in case of steroid, but if the patient is the compliance is low, then the patient can be told to take the PPI once a day. You can shift over toward pantoprazole or omeprazole 40 milligram.
What is the role of sucralfate, madam?
Sucralfate is good. I do give syrup, sucralfate in the form of syrup. It does decrease the symptoms of esophagitis, mainly if the patient has those symptoms along with laryngeal symptoms.
So what are the alginates, madam? Can you please...
Actually, the true alginates are not available with us in India. So what we have is Gaviscon, which is not. It comes in a syrup form, and it is a form of alginate which neutralizes the pepsin within the acid reflux.
It comes with combination with other antacids.
No.
What are you telling is the trade name, madam? Gaviscon.
Sorry, your voice is very low.
What you are mentioning is a trade name or it's a.
It's a trade name. Yeah, it's a trade name.
Gaviscon, madam. What is it?
Gaviscon. Sorry, I am not supposed to use any trade names, but.
Thank you.
What is the role of antibiotics? Any role in the treatment of LPR?
Yeah, if for treatment of H. pylori, I don't but the gastroenterologists as a treatment for H. pylori infection.
Which antibiotic you prefer, madam?
As I said, I really don't give any antibiotic, but if the patient is comes from a gastroenterologist with an H. pylori infection, patient generally is prescribed medication for that.
What is the role? Is there any role of vitamin B12, ma'am?
No, not that I have not heard of that.
What is the difference between use and efficacy of sucralfate and Gaviscon? Are both given before the...
Gaviscon is an alginate, so it neutralizes the pepsin in the reflux, and the sucralfate is more of given for esophagitis, symptoms of esophagitis.
LPR with hoarseness of voice.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any voice care plan even with PPI? After ruling out the gastrointestinal assessment, do you get the patients to do any voice care rehabilitation?
Most of the patients have this because of chronic throat clearing. Many of the patients either develop vocal nodules or congestion of the vocal cords, and they have to strain their voices. So voice rest is advised. Patients are advised not to do any throat clearing. This is to be avoided. If they have a tendency to do this, then the patients are asked to either swallow the saliva or drink water or maybe just cough once and clear the throat, because the increased the viscid mucus secretions do tend to cause this throat clearing.
Ma'am, there are a lot of questions coming regarding Gaviscon. I'll just read out them.
Yes.
And can you combine mucine gel with Gaviscon? Then what is the dose of Gaviscon and how long do you give?
Yeah, so dose is 10 ml twice a day. It has to be given immediately after meals.
And how long do you prescribe it?
I prescribe it for a month at least a month.
Do you combine it with mucine gel?
No. if sometimes the patient does not like the taste of Gaviscon, then I give mucin gel or some form of antacid with sucralfate to decrease the esophagitis symptoms.
What is the role of biofilms in NPR?
No idea, sorry.
I think you have answered that. I think we have come to the end of the presentations. Most of the participants' doubts have been cleared.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. And we have a lot of congratulatory messages in the chat box.
Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you so much. And thank you for organizing this webinar. And I saw that there were a lot of participants, and I'm glad that all of them could gain something from this. And thank you so much for organizing this.
Thank you once again, ma'am. With this, we end the webinar for today.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah.